I'm Sonny Webster. You used to come in my mama's bakery.
Sonny Webster? Sonny Webster, I remember you.
You used to stand behind the cash register and give everybody the wrong change.
Well, I never was too good at math.
You're telling me? Sonny Webster, golly.
Something tells me those characters are from the South. That's a scene from Norma Rae with Sally Field and Bo Bridges. It's about her attempt to unionize some downtrodden textile workers in the South. It's one of five new films we'll be reviewing on Sneak Previews, your guide to what's good and bad at your local movie theater. And this is Roger Ebert, the Pulitzer Prize-winning film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
Across the aisle from me is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune and CBS TV News in Chicago. And among the new movies we'll review on this program is Get Out Your Handkerchiefs, which was chosen as the year's best film by the National Society of Film Critics. And I think we're going to have quite a disagreement on that one.
I'm ready for that.
Okay. And also probably we'll disagree on Agatha, which is a new British thriller starring Dustin Hoffman and Vanessa Redgrave. We'll also take a look at The Last Wave, a supernatural thriller from Australia. And now Gene's going to start with a new Walt Disney movie, The North Avenue Irregulars.
Roger, there's a report out of Hollywood that Disney Studios is going to try to make a wider variety of movies in the future, not just this usual juvenile slapstick stuff for kids who like to see people fall on their faces, see cars split in two, and dogs fly through the air. Well, after seeing The North Avenue Irregulars, it's easy to see why the Disney folks are finally realizing they've got to modernize their material. It's wearing awfully thin now. In North Avenue Irregulars, a group of housewives play undercover detectives in an effort to get rid of mobsters in their small town. The women pose as numbers bettors and try to tape their conversation with a numbers collector. Guess what? Their tape recorder doesn't work.
We look like the Bobbsey twins. Or triplets.
Oh. Did you make the bet yet?
Shh. You got it.
I got a tape recorder. Is it on?
No.
Why don't you put it on so that it'll be running when we make the bet?
Good idea.
That way, that's reverse.
What'll it be?
A coffee, please.
Big is.
And a primer on 268. My horoscope says that even numbers are going to be very lucky for me today.
Vince, 268.
Did you get it?
I think so. You better make sure.
Wow, isn't that a scream? Now I got a question for you, Roger. What would a Disney comedy be without its chase scenes?
You got me.
A short subject. The last third of this picture, like all of the Disney comedies, is just chase scenes as the undercover ladies eventually begin rounding up the criminals by crashing their cars into the crooks' cars. And Cloris Leachman enters the chase scene right from her beauty parlor.
Easy. Baraka. Give it to him.
She broke her fingernails. Hardy, har, har. And that's why the folks at Disney are thinking of changing their game, because North Avenue Irregulars is thoroughly mediocre.
Mediocre is certainly the word, and that's a double shame because it has a good cast.
Yes.
You notice Barbara Harris there.
Right.
Cloris Leachman is good in this film. The premise would have been interesting. A preacher starts in a small town with a church. The gangsters are in town. The ladies' club takes off after it, but they just absolutely never connect.
They always go to the slapstick. Every car that gets hit, you know, the back of the car falls off, a fender falls off. They're just interested in
fenders.
And then
they have the extra beats. Everybody's supposed to say, ho, 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 that car's door fell off or something.
Exactly.
It is insulting to them, even of kids. I mean, go to see the movie in a theater. The kids are running out to the candy counter. They don't care.
More action there, yeah.
Okay, let's forget about North Avenue. Let's go to the outback of Australia. Mm-hmm. And to an offbeat thriller named The Last Wave. It's about the tribal magic of the Aborigines, and specifically their belief that ancient rituals can predict modern events and perhaps even cause them. The movie stars Richard Chamberlain as a tough lawyer who finds himself linked to the Aborigines through what the natives call dream time, a time that has nothing to do with clocks and calendars, but has everything to do with the past and future of the human soul, because they believe dreams are as real life. Now here's a scene where Chamberlain meets with an Aborigine wise man and realizes for the first time that they share a deep and powerful connection.
You were outside my house yesterday. You frightened my wife. What do you want? Who are you?
Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Are you a fish?
No.
Are you a snake? Are you a man?
Scene has kind of an eerie power to it. The movie contrasts Chamberlain's ordinary everyday world, his friends, his family, and his job, with ancient secrets that seem ready to overwhelm him. And the way that other world, the magical Aborigine world, is introduced at the beginning makes the movie's first hour creepy and frightening. We begin to feel disquieted and easy, but then the magic and the plot dissolve into a much more conventional thriller formula, and Richard Chamberlain is so cold and so distant as a character that we don't really care what happens to him. So the cataclysmic ending isn't equal to the fears and fantasies we started out with.
That's exactly my feeling. The picture was creepy at the beginning and actually informational. I mean, we got to think about an alternative way of thinking about dreams and knowledge.
I was reminded of a much better picture from Australia called Walkabout, in which a young girl goes out into the outback and meets an Aborigine and their cultures mingle and so forth and so on. This one started out with that kind of fascination.
Yeah, and then what happens is that it becomes just a conventional horror story. The house gets destroyed and you wonder if Chamberlain's going to survive, but as you point out, you don't care. It's a flat character.
Yeah, we've been there before.
Yeah, right. they blew what could have been a good picture. Now we come to a mystery about a mystery writer. In December of 1926, and this is factual, English mystery writer Agatha Christie disappeared from her home and turned up 11 days later, registered at a country resort in the name of her husband's mistress. Now, the movie Agatha is a fictional account of what may have happened during those 11 days. And what happens in the movie version is that an enterprising American newspaper man, played by Dustin Hoffman, tracks Mrs. Christie to the health resort where apparently she's plotting to kill her husband's mistress. But later in the film, he corners Agatha Christie, played by Vanessa Redgrave, outside her hotel room. And he tells her he understands the pain she is going through. Now, this is no traditional seduction scene. Watch the way Dustin Hoffman communicates the respect he has for her as a woman and as an artist.
I know you're in trouble. I know something is very wrong.
Care for a cigarette?
No.
Would you care for a kiss?
Yes.
Now, there's a murder mystery, too. Is she going to kill her husband's mistress? But really, I think it is the romance, the love story, that made me be thoroughly captivated by this film. It is skillfully made, exceedingly well acted, very tender and fragile. Now, Dustin Hoffman, reportedly, is not pleased with the final edited version of the film, but I don't know what he's really complaining about.
I've got something in common with Dustin Hoffman. I'm not pleased with the final version of the film, either.
Why not?
It seemed to me to move too slowly. They march through the plot. We can see everything coming before it gets there.
Now, one time, last show, we had a period film, and you hit me because I said the same complaint. You said, but yeah, 100 years ago,
okay,
people
we were
didn't
talking
do it.
About the Great Train Robbery. Yeah. That movie glided at a certain pace. This one slogs. Okay. And at the same time, I didn't. Now, this scene had a lot of chemistry between the two people. Most of the movie didn't have that same kind of electricity.
Well, he's so nervous about her, Roger. He has never met anything like this woman. He comes from America. This woman is a fragile, extremely talented person. He's startled
by her.
See, that's
why we disagree. He's not nervous at all. He's a newspaper man. He's met all kinds of people. She's the one who doesn't know what
he's
to make
startled.
Of him.
He's startled. He's in love. The tough newspaper guy is feeling a little bit of love and awe for it. Remember, he's a writer, and here's a great writer. So I really think it's accountable. You know, this is just one of those odd cases where we'd looked at the same piece of film, we have totally different reactions. I guess that happens sometimes.
I guess so. I just didn't buy it. I couldn't believe the two of them. Yeah. I walked out of the theater, I said, that film must have been at least 4 hours long. But then sometimes, even most of the time, I suppose when you walk out of the theater, you know whether a movie is good or bad or in between. But sometimes a movie really is hard to categorize, and Norma Rae is a movie like that. It never quite pulls itself together, and yet it has some really fine things in it. And one of the best things is the performance by Sally Field as Norma Rae Webster. She's 31, she's got a couple of kids, and she works in the textile mill like everybody else in this small southern town. And when a labor organizer turns up and tries to organize a union in the mill, his arguments make a lot of sense to her, so much sense that she becomes a full-time volunteer organizer, and that causes a lot of troubles at home.
You ain't getting any sleep. I ain't getting any sleep. We gotta get to work in the morning.
I got 100 calls to make tonight.
Is that going on our phone bill?
You can take it out of my paycheck, right?
Damn, milk is sour.
I didn't have a chance to get to the market.
Well, you didn't have a chance to get to the market, did you? And you didn't get to the washing, and you didn't get to the kids, and you didn't get to me.
Is that right?
That's right. That's right. Damn TV dinners, kids going around in dirty jeans. I'm going around without altogether.
Maybe she feels a little guilty, and that's why they make up. You know, in a way, he has a point. She has been spending morning, noon, and night working for the union. But Sally Field really makes us believe in Norma Rae in scenes like that. And in the fierce and spunky way, she sticks to her guns. And along the way, Norma Rae finds herself developing into a different person, which is kind of what the movie is about. A new world has opened up to her, new ideas. And most of them come from Ron Liebman, who plays the union organizer from New York. One afternoon, they go for a swim.
What the hell is that? Get out. Something's flipping around my face.
Those are minnows.
Those are what?
Minnows. They won't hurt you.
You better not.
You sure are a fish out of water down here.
This is not exactly my native habitat.
Reuben, what would you be doing on a day like this at home?
Play some handball at the Y. Go see Aida at the Met. Eat Chinese. Play a little poker, hit the sack.
I've been two places in my life. I've been to Henleyville. Been on down to Piston.
Oh, you'd love New York. You would. Wow. Super town. Most beautiful women in the world. Best food. Opera, theater, ballet.
Reuben, you're homesick.
God.
That scene is a little bit misleading because most of the picture takes place in the mill and not down at the old swimming hole, but that camaraderie between the two of them is at the heart of the film. But the rest of the movie has a lot of problems. The relationship between Norma Rae and her husband, Beau Bridges, for example, is never convincingly developed. It's stuck in. It never seems to fit. The screenplay is too predictable. Some of the dialogue of the mill worker sounds too self-conscious and too awkwardly ideological, and so the movie is flawed. It's not perfect, but it does succeed because of the sheer human intensity of that performance by Sally Field.
Yeah, she's very good, but as you mentioned, once we get to the mill, which is the main crux of the story, I suppose, you know, the film has such an obviously good heart. It's on the side of these oppressed workers. I don't know, films like that, they don't really impress me because they take such an easy road. I thought this should be a rougher film. I thought, for example, that using an organizer in the swimming hole there should have got his head knocked off as soon as he showed up in town.
Well, he doesn't, though, as a matter of fact. But the thing is, this movie kind of exists. We always, people laugh at movie critics, I think. You're always talking about it works on this level, doesn't work on this level. This movie really doesn't work on the level of the story. It really does work on the level of that character that Sally Field creates. I'm thinking about a movie last year, An Unmarried Woman with Jill Clayburgh. Well, the year before that, she made Gable and Lombard. It was a flop. We all said, what a terrible actress. Then she came back. She was terrific. It's the same with Sally Field. She's been in a lot of mediocre roles. She's never really had a great performance until this film, and she creates a character we care about a lot more than we care about the movie.
Yes, I liked her, but there's one character that I hate in the picture, and that's the guy in that swimming hole. I'm getting back to him. He, Ron Liebman, he plays Kaz on TV, and he played this role of the brash young union organizer just like he was playing TV. He really chews up the cinema, you know, grimacing all the time. It was obnoxious. I wanted to punch this guy out.
The scene before that, we saw Beau Bridges. He's okay. He gives a good performance, but he gets married. That's one scene. They fight. That's another scene. There were just four or five scenes in the movie that are thrown in with her marriage that never seem to work with the relationship she has with Liebman.
Yeah, I guess you're saying there really are two movies. One, go see it if you like her, but the rest of the story doesn't make it at all.
Okay.
And now, for my second fragile love story for the show, the first one was Agatha. The second one is Get Out Your Handkerchiefs, a French film with English subtitles, and it's already an Oscar nominee that has been named Best Picture of the Year by the National Society of Film Critics. Well, I don't think it's the best film of the year, but I was intrigued by Handkerchiefs, the story of a husband who tries to perk up his always depressed wife. The film is an offbeat, sometimes very serious comedy, and it's always surprising, as in the beginning of the picture, when the husband decides to offer his wife a strange man he sees admiring her in a restaurant. Pickup scene, it's a delivery. Unfortunately, that alliance doesn't work out either. The solution to this woman's problem comes in an unusual package, a precocious 13-year-old boy she meets when she goes to work at a summer camp. This kid is the butt of a lot of jokes by the other campers. He's much smarter than they are. So this woman takes pity on him, and then she falls in love with him, I think because the boy needs her more than any man ever has. And one night, their relationship becomes more sexual. Shocking? No, I don't think so. Eventually they become lovers, and as unconventional as that may seem, in this movie it comes across as totally reasonable, totally natural. Why? I think because of the purity of their relationship. Just like Dustin Hoffman's character in Agatha, Get Out Your Handkerchiefs is about a man, albeit a young and small one, who really respects a woman. And that's a refreshing emotion to see, as is the whole movie, Get Out Your Handkerchiefs.
In other words, I take it you like this film.
I liked it a lot, yeah.
I thought this was one of the worst films I'd ever seen.
I
thought it was decadent,
why.
Depraved, dumb,
why is
stupid.
It?
The characters were unattractive.
Wait a minute. That unattractive? That kid isn't, he's a smart kid. The woman, beautiful. What's wrong with these people?
I'm talking about what's inside. There's nothing inside the kid. He's just brought on, I think, for shock value. The woman spends most of the movie knitting and not talking. Occasionally
she
faints in order to bring a little
depressed.
Thrill to everyone.
There are lots of people that are depressed. And
this
lots
movie
of
is not about depression. This movie is kind of an arrogant intellectual exercise in minimal human emotion.
Why? What do you think it's trying to say?
I don't think it's trying to say anything.
Oh, yes.
I really found this movie offensive. I said,
why?
I'm not talking about morally offensive. It was offensive to my intelligence.
All right, let me tell you what I think it's trying to
say.
I
wish you would,
okay.
Yes.
I think it's trying to say that the size of the package doesn't mean anything. It's the quality of the emotion. And the men, the other two men, are boorish to her. And this kid responds to her.
The other two men are boorish. She has three words in the first hour of the movie. I can't understand why
anybody. Because they're so offensive to her.
Is that why she's quiet?
Yes.
Why doesn't she leave?
Because she doesn't know how to leave, I guess.
Well, I wish she'd find out in the next movie because I don't want to see this one again.
Well, we really disagree. I think it's a fine film. I think it's not an obvious film. I think it's one worth studying.
I think it should be cut up to make ukulele picks.
Well, enough of that. Here's Spot to remind us it's time for Dog of the Week, where each of us picks the week's worst movies.
Hi, Spot. Thanks for barking after I was talking about that last movie. And by the way, I like your collar there. I think you went shopping over the weekend. Mm-hmm. My dog this week is Debbie Does Dallas, an X-rated hardcore porno film. that rips off everybody's favorite pro football cheerleaders, the Dallas Cowgirls. The movie, needless to say, has nothing to do with the Cowgirls, but it got a lot of publicity when the Dallas team sued for infringement of copyright. And believe me, copyright is the least of the things that are infringed on in this movie. It's about a young girl's attempt to raise enough money to fly to Dallas and become a cheerleader. And while working as a clerk in a sporting goods store, Debbie finds out in no time at all what a good sport the owner of the store is. But the movie is so boring and repetitive and tasteless, like most hardcore films, that about halfway through I began to realize that it doesn't need a movie critic to analyze it. It needs a gynecologist.
Well, I saw it. I thought she was kind of cute in the film. But anyway, Roger, you know what happened to Nancy Kwan, the Oriental actress who became a big splash some 17 years ago with two fine films, The World of Susie Wong and Flower Drum Song?
Frankly, no.
No, and you don't care either, I guess. Well, sad to say, Nancy Kwan has fallen on hard times. She's the star of My Dog of the Week, a little film called Wonder Women. That's Wonder Women, not to be confused with the comic book or the TV show, although I suppose if you were confused and wanted the picture of the ripoff artist who made this trash, probably you'd be happy to sell you a ticket. In the film, Nancy Kwan plays a crazy surgeon who runs a multi-million dollar body shop, and I mean literally a body shop. She and her henchwoman kidnap famous athletes and surgically attach parts of their bodies to rich old men who are about to kick the bucket. Of course, she charges them an arm and a leg.
Oh.
Now, here you see her right-hand girl who's about to get her a right leg. Oh. What an outrageous story. You might say this is one that really goes out on a limb.
Oh, you might. Okay, so much for the dogs. Now to recap the major films on this week's program. Neither one of us liked the tedious slapstick of Walt Disney's G-rated North Avenue Irregulars, so we both voted no. We can't recommend you see this film. We also gave a double no to The Last Wave, a thriller from Australia that was exciting, but only in its first hour. We split on Agatha, the mystery about the 11 missing days in the life of Agatha Christie. Gene loved it.
Yes, I did.
Okay, I thought it was lifeless and slow, and we had a closer split, though, on Norma Rae. Gene couldn't quite buy it. I could. He thought it was contrived. But I thought, we both thought, actually, it had a good heart and an excellent performance by Sally Field. We disagreed much more strongly on the French film Get Out Your Handkerchiefs.
You bet.
Gene enjoyed its provocative story and offbeat humor.
Yes, yes.
I thought it was quite simply one of the most boring exercises in collective stupidity that I had ever seen.
I think I heard you the first time.
Okay.
That's it for this show. Next time, we'll take a look at Fast Break, a new comedy about a college basketball team coached by Gabe Kaplan, better known as TV's Mr. Cotter. Also, China Syndrome, a thriller about a cover-up in a nuclear power plant. Jane Fonda and Jack Lemmon co-star. And a review of The Deer Hunter, a film about the effects of the Vietnam War on a small town in the Midwest. The Deer Hunter, then, is one of the most eagerly awaited films of the year because it's been nominated for 9 Academy Awards, including Best Picture. Robert De Niro stars as a Vietnam paratrooper. A review, then, of The Deer Hunter next time on Sneak Previews. And until then, see you at the movies.
Funding for this program is provided by this station and by other public television stations.